Exactly 1 month from now, Donald Trump, he will get sworn in. Barack Obama will hand over power, and Michelle Obama will also become a former first lady. She spoke about all of that and much more with Oprah Winfrey last night. And we want to get the read on the first lady from the man who wrote the book on her. It is called Michelle Obama, A Life, and author Peter Slevin. He's kind enough to join us now. Peter, thanks for the time.
Glad to be here.
You know, I thought it was a really interesting interview, and I thought pretty revealing and in keeping with Michelle Obama. There doesn't seem to be too much of a veneer of BS. She seems to be pretty straightforward. A couple moments in there, and I want to get your take on it. Obviously, in the immediate aftermath of the Access Hollywood tape, which, as we all know, had Donald Trump talking to Billy Bush, and unbeknownst to them, they were being recorded for posterity. Her immediate reaction to it.
To have a candidate for the presidency speaking in such terms about women, as I said, was not a normal thing. So my response, you know, in light of what I was seeing from my female staff, what I was hearing from my daughters, their reaction to it, for me required a different kind of response. You know, you can't just stand before people and just give a regular political speech. I mean, I was scheduled to go out on the stump right after this was happening. And the question was, well, do I just go out there and act like that didn't happen?
This was, as she said, a moment that shook her to her core. She must, I would imagine here, and if you, as you know, or read between the lines, still be gobsmacked that this guy's going to be the next president.
There's no question that she's appalled by Donald Trump. She made that very clear on the campaign trail. Even before the Billy Bush Access Hollywood tape, she was out campaigning for Hillary Clinton and saying, look, this man is not prepared to be president of the United States. He is not an adult. He could not be the adult in the room. She said he's trafficking in lies and fears and prejudice, which are very strong words from a first lady. But when you think about who he is and what he represents and what a contrast that is with the way she has led her life and the issues she cares about, it's not surprising, is it?
It's not. And another undercurrent to the conversation last night was obviously the firsts. Obviously, the Barack and Michelle Obama, the first African-American, first family that we've ever had. And while she didn't delve too deeply into the racial aspect, it was there.
I've been in the world. I've worked in every sector. And you don't do that without coming up against some stuff, you know, having your feelings hurt, having people say things that aren't true, you know, and it's not just about race. I mean, you know, it's just life hits you. So over the course of living, you learn how to protect yourself in it. You learn how to take in what you need and get rid of the stuff that's clearly not true. You know, so I have a very good sense of who I am. And my view to this stuff has always been like, it's always a challenge. It's like, oh, you think that? I'll show you. Because I'm going to work so hard and I'm going to be so on it that my actions will speak for themselves and I don't have to say anything.
To that point, there were obviously in the last 8 years a lot of ugly things said, maybe not directly to them, but she seemed to have heard them. To your point where how people spoke about the first family and angry black woman things that were referenced, how much did that cut and how much did she decide to put up a wall? That for the last eight years, she didn't let people in as much, maybe because of it.
That's right. Well, you'll remember her comment back in February of 2008 that got so much attention when she said, for the first time in my adult life, I'm really proud of my country. And immediately Republicans went after her. The very next day, Cindy McCain said, well, you know, I've always been proud of my country. She felt misunderstood. You know, half the country knew exactly what she meant. I mean, there was a guy named Barack Hussein Obama, an African-American man who was in the process of winning, 10 primaries and caucuses in a row. It was a remarkable moment. And she withdrew at that point. It stung. And she not only felt bad that maybe she wasn't doing the right thing and wasn't coming across the way she had hoped, she was deeply worried, and she said she lost sleep over the possibility that she was hurting her husband's campaign. So she did tone things down. She did change her tone significantly and reemerged at the Democratic National Convention in Denver. And after that speech in 2008, her numbers went up and they never came down.
You know, another point, Peter, that and I would say the clip that probably has gotten the most amount of attention has been her comments about hope and the absence of it. To your mind, did it convey what you really feel? Is that people now know what it's not, what it's like to not have any hope, in that obviously half of this country felt more hopeful with Donald Trump?
Well, you certainly saw that Donald Trump decided that he knew what Michelle actually meant when she was speaking about hope. I think in her mind, it's crystal clear. This has been a very depressing turn of events. The election of Donald Trump, the nastiness of his commentary, the hurtful words that he used against so many people, many of whom are minorities or who are voiceless, the very people the Obamas have tried to help. So she was very clear about how an awful lot of people who had felt pretty hopeful about progress are feeling pretty down right now.
You know, towards the end of the interview, Oprah Winfrey referenced her potential political future, speaking of Michelle Obama. And she, while dismissing it out of hand to a degree, what I thought was interesting was she didn't say which office, and she made it clear, I wouldn't put my family through another 8 years in the White House, presuming, A, you're the party nominee, B, you win, and you win twice. How much of it, is she aware that she's got these sky-high popularity ratings, and B, she believes she could do the job, let alone be elected? And finally, Peter, how much of it is just that she wants to get the heck out of Pennsylvania Avenue in D.C., well, I guess stay in D.C., but leave the Oval Office and have a real life again? Because she seemed to be aware there's going to be a bubble no matter where she is once she leaves that office still.
Politics is not her world. She's always said so. I mean, can you imagine her in a room with Mitch McConnell? It is not how she would enjoy spending her day. She's certainly aware that some people are saying Michelle 2020, and she's thought about it pretty deeply and said this is really not for us. And she's also made pretty darn clear that she just wishes she could get a little bit of time away. You know, she says, gosh, if I could do one thing, it would be to drive in a car with the windows down. You know, Barack Obama has talked about how he just wishes he could sit alone on a park bench. It is a very odd world that they've had to inhabit these 8 years. And she's very much looking, as you say, to just get out of Dodge for a while.
Well, Peter, I certainly appreciate your time. And I know it's been a busy day for you. Thank you.
Happy to do it. Thanks a million.
All right. Coming up next, everybody, what the holidays are all about. Comes down to family. We'll have a great story. Please stay with us.